Very good. Thank you. This meeting is now adjourned. Moving on to a special study session meeting at 6:25 p.m. Calling this meeting to order. And would everyone join me for the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note we are all still here. There are no special orders of the day. At this time, I will entertain any public comment on this special study session where we will be discussing the joint powers agreement for the East Bay Community Energy Authority. Is there anyone who wishes to speak? Okay, seeing none, let's move on to the study session. This is consideration of East Bay Community Energy Authority joint powers agreement. Hi, Nancy.
Hi. Good evening, Council and Madam Mayor. We're here tonight. I'm really just piggybacking on what Michael Gein is here to talk to you about, which is the JPA and its contents, because the county wants comments on that by July 1st to keep on their aggressive schedule. So, but I'm going to just give you a little context. We are where the process is now. So Mayor Martinez is the delegate to the steering committee for the CCE. She has, for the last several months, had a competing meeting. So I, as the alternate, have been going to those meetings. There was a technical study that went out for an RFP for a technical study to see how feasible this whole enterprise would be. And that study has been completed, and the JPA itself is almost completed, again, pending comments. We're one of only a couple of cities that is addressing us in this way at council now, so I applaud you for being proactive that way. County staff will take this to their Board of Supervisors in July 19th, and they'll be asked to pass a CCE ordinance authorizing the county to form the JPA. County is also separately doing a solar siting survey that probably will have less to do with us than it will East County, for instance, where they have more land for that. The goal is to launch the CCE, East Bay Clean Energy, in mid-2017. It's sort of late spring is the target. These are popping up all over. Marin Clean Energy and Sonoma Clean Power have been around. Marin Clean Energy was, I think, the second one in California. But San Francisco just launched. Peninsula is launching in October. Silicon Valley is launching just before this one, should it go through. So this is what's happening now in energy. I'm going to hand this off now. Mark Fulmer, who is a principal with MRW and Associates, which is the firm that led on the technical feasibility study. He'll be here. He'll talk to you about the assumptions and findings of the study. And then he'll hand it over to Michael Gina, who will talk to you about the JPA. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. Welcome the opportunity here to talk about our results and be able to answer any of the questions. Make sure I can work this thing. A key piece to understanding the study is understanding what type of electrical load the CCE will be needing to meet. And this is a little snapshot showing what the load is by the different classes of customers. So commercial customers are about half of the county's load, with residential being about a third, and then the remainder the other third. You can note a couple things on this picture. First of all, you have the first few years, they're phasing it in. That is, they aren't The study didn't assume that it would be serving all the potential customers on the first day. It assumed that it would be a third of them in the first year, adding a third and then adding a third, just to make the process a little bit easier on the folks trying to get it off the ground. Second, you can see that once it hits that plateau of about 7,000 gigawatt hours, it remains pretty flat. And that is consistent with the forecasting that's done at the California Energy Commission. And what's happening there is any natural load growth that's happening due to more people moving in or other economic development is being counteracted by energy efficiency that's going on throughout the county, as well as rooftop solar and distributed generation. So you put it all together and you end up with a relatively flat amount that they'd have to be serving throughout time as the provider of electricity. Yep. There we go. This is a breakdown of the major cities in the potential CCE. Emeryville here would be a little over 3%, so you're in the that little other slice of the pie. But you have the big three that dominate: Oakland, Fremont, and Hayward. The three of them together represent about half of the load. A major piece of what we had to do is look at what costs the CCE would incur and compare that to the cost that the customers would pay were they to remain PG&E customers. And this shows a forecast of the rates for PG&E in the two major pieces. The bottom piece, which they're calling the non-generation piece, is for the transmission and distribution. So effectively the wires, maintaining all the transmission system and the distribution, doing the meter reading and the likes. The piece that we have to concentrate on is that blue part, that's the generation part. And that's the cost of the energy that PG&E is providing. And a CCE customer would not pay that blue generation rate, but instead would be pay with whatever the CCE would be charging. So as we move forward and start looking at some of the numbers, we're just going to be looking at that blue piece because that's the only part that really goes into the comparison. We were asked to look at three different scenarios with that varied with the amount of renewable content in them. We have RPS, which is Renewable Portfolio Standard, which is the state requirements on how much renewable energy each provider has to include in their portfolio. The first case was just meeting the state requirements. The second case, it was one that was more aggressive, where they would start at half of the content being the qualifying renewables, and then take other steps to lower the greenhouse gas emissions. And then the third would be an even more aggressive case, where they start at half and then ramp up in the first 5 years to 80% of the portfolio being from these qualifying renewables. So as we move forward, we'll generally be talking more about the case two and three, because those are the ones that are of the most interest. Just meeting the minimum requirements loses a lot of value because you don't get some of the other benefits that people are interested in. Now for the renewable content, you can get it from a number of places. You can purchase it from an existing renewable facility, which is what you'll have to do in the early years because you don't have time to build anything new. And then you can build new renewables to serve the load. And you can do that in a couple different places. And the figure here shows for scenarios two and three, the different sources where the CCE could potentially develop their own projects. The bottom two pieces, which are called large solar and wind, are for projects that are outside of the immediate county. The upper two that say in county are for different sizes of solar projects that would be located within the physical county. We had to make that differentiation for a couple reasons. First of all, when you go outside of the Alameda County into the Central Valley in particular, or even down south into some of the deserts, the costs of developing these are much lower than you would have in the county. Land prices are much less, and other costs of doing business tend to be a bit less than they are in the Bay Area. I think we're all pretty aware of that kind of thing. And secondly, the county is obviously physically constrained, and the question is how much can you actually develop and build in the county is a good question. And in fact, you heard that the county is doing a solar survey to get a better handle on what can realistically be done in the county. So the breakdown, there are effectively my team's professional estimates of what seemed to be a reasonable penetration without being too aggressive, but still trying to meet some of these goals of development that's being caused by the CCE, as well as locally cited for economic development and other reasons. This is one of the key economic indicators. What we have here is a comparison of the PG&E rate, which is the somewhat squiggly line at the top, and then the bars that show the cost of doing business for the CCE, broken up into the major pieces. So the bottom two bars, the blue and the red one, show the raw cost of power by the qualifying renewables in the blue, and then if it's saying non-renewable, so the one that any other power that's being bought either from fossil plants or hydro in the red. And you can tell those two make up the vast majority of the costs. And that makes sense. That's where the dollars are. A couple other things to note. The little green bar in the middle is the just operations of the CCE. And as a piece, it's not particularly big, but it's still obviously important that it's being run efficiently, because if you're not doing well in your planning and your operations, then those other two bars are going to be expanding because of not being able to acquire power at a good price. And then the last is that tops bar, which is labeled the PCIA, sort of a teal, and that is the fee that the state authorizes PG&E to charge customers of the CCEs for effectively the right to exit the PG&E system, and in fact the opportunity to effectively make those counties and people who do not select CCE whole. The concern was that by the fact that, let's say, Alameda County people exit PG&E, they are stuck with a bunch of costs that they have to then charge higher rates on people in other counties in Fresno or and the likes to make sure that they're not harmed.
So Mr. Fulmer, these exit fees are of concern, definitely.
So they should.
Here in this graph that you're showing me, we're still way below PG&E, but I have a hard time coming to terms with the fact that we're looking out to 2030 and still thinking that we're going to have to pay these fees. Are we just being conservative?
Well, effectively, that is the current policy, yeah. Is that they are in perpetuity.
In perpetuity.
Well, effectively,
it doesn't really make any sense, because you buy energy for a certain amount of time.
This is true, but these fees are associated with large investments that get paid for and amortized over like 30 years. Mm-hmm. So if you have PG&E entered into a new renewable contract in 2014,
right,
and that contract goes for 20 years, that contract will be included in the PCIA calculation for those 20 years. I completely agree with your skepticism about this, and in fact there's efforts between the existing CCAs and other parties that find that to be a rather ridiculous item.
Well, but this would be one of the first orders of business for our JPA, I think.
And in fact, the Sonoma and Marin and Lancaster have been trying to get this through or get some attention to this and the fundamental oddness and unfairness.
Yeah.
And I think as you get more CCEs on board, you have a louder voice and have a better chance of getting perhaps some success in that.
Well, I'm still really glad to see that the rates will still fall below PG&E, so I'm happy to see this chart.
Yeah, for scenario two, that's absolutely, using our base case assumptions, that's the case. I'll have lots of caveats here at the end.
Okay.
But that's... In forecasting, that's just the way it is.
Thank you.
For scenario three, if you remember, that had a much more aggressive amount of renewables coming in, and therefore the bottom blue bar is much higher. And because renewables tend to be more expensive than the alternative, that gap between PG&E and the CCE becomes rather narrow. And that's, again, not to be expected, but it's also encouraging that in our base case, it doesn't necessarily cross. It doesn't look, you know, horrid to begin with. Mm-hmm. And we'll explore a little bit more what might happen in the sensitivities here in a moment. So you pick that up. That gap there is the key piece in understanding the or appreciating what the financial viability is likely to be. For what does that mean for bill savings? We have, for the scenarios 2 and 3 for a residential customer, we have some typical numbers up there. So for the scenario 2 that had the wider gap, it would vary from year to year, but you'd be typically on the order of a bit over 5% on average. And that goes down to a much smaller number when we have the very aggressive renewable scenario, where it's just a bit under PG&E and would probably could be a lot more a lot higher risk of perhaps exceeding PG&E in that case.
Do you have a similar slide for commercial?
What you can do for the commercial, the percentages would be the same. We're pro rata across all. So for the percentages for the commercials would be the same as we're showing here, albeit the dollar savings obviously would be different.
Why would the percentage be the same? Because their billing rates are different than residential billing rates.
This is true, but the way one is said, first of all, the CCE has the ability to set the rates as they wish. The way we've set our rates in our example is explicitly to have each class have an equal percentage of savings off of PG&E. So that was our assumption in presenting the information. And again, if the so effectively when the CCE would set their rates, they would say, all right, we have PG&E is at 10 cents and we want to offer a 4% savings, and so it would take it down to 9.6 cents, but then they would pro rata that across the different customer classes. It's been clear to me that various towns and cities have their climate action plans that they would like the CCA to contribute to and offer some significant greenhouse gas savings. What we've found is that some savings are indeed possible, but it gets a little bit tricky from this fact. We can see the different mixes of power content from the CCE. And I want to call your attention to the blue part. And beyond the normal, beyond the renewables that we've been talking about, you have that remainder. And the question is, where does that remainder come from? If you just go to the market and buy fossil fuels, you're probably not going to get much, if any, greenhouse gas reductions. Simply due to the fact that PG&E has a large hydro and non-emitting resource. So if you want to beat PG&E that way, you also have to get some other non-carbon emitting resources, and those generally tend to be larger hydroelectric. Now, those resources are readily available. You can go out and purchase it and get contracts for that. And the point in the greenhouse gas planning is to be aware of that, and when you do your resource planning, to make sure you take that non-carbon content resources into account and make sure you include that in the portfolio if one wants to have the greenhouse gas benefits that I understand you all want to have. Some key sensitivities in our analysis were listed here. A bit of a wonky thing is we noticed the first one is the relicensing of the Diablo Canyon Nuclear Power Plant, and in fact,
it's PG&E not relicensed.
Just announced today that they were not going to relicense it, and I'm proud that my analysts had called that one, and we assumed that it would not be relicensed in our base case. Also, those are the other key cost elements that could cause some problems listed there. So this shows the sensitivities to these things. So it's showing the price differential between the CCE and PG&E, with positive being good. That means you're beating PG&E when the bars are positive. Two things to be noting here. The red and the blue bars, which are the less aggressive renewable cases, show a certain amount of robustness. The benefits aren't as high as they are with the base case, but there's a bit of room to play under some of our sensitivity cases, with the exception of what we're calling the stress scenario, where we pile everything bad that can happen on all at once and assume there remains that way.
Mr. Fulmer, did your company take into account any possibility of microgrid or energy storage that might happen?
We did not. Those could very well happen. They would be happening in the latter years of the forecast, in the late 2020s, before they would start having a market economic effect. Mm-hmm. And I think we were trying to forecast enough things that I didn't want to get quite that speculative.
Well, that would that would only help our situation, I would think.
I would hope so, and I would hope that we are seeing them at that point, but we'll see. The green bars are the very aggressive ones, and you can see those are much closer and would have a relatively high likelihood of having some years where the prices would not be lower than PG&E, and that would be something that the JPA would have to think about and deal with in their planning, the cases where you'd have isolated years where your product may be indeed more costly than PG&E's. Another big piece that we were asked to look at were the jobs and the macroeconomic impacts. And for this, we used a specialty firm that does macroeconomic forecasting, generally for government agencies, to test the impacts of various government policies. So they were well suited to help us out here. So what we found were that there are two sources for the job creation coming from this program. The first is the fact that because the businesses and individuals in the county are paying less for their power, that means they have more disposable money to spend on other things. So businesses can invest more, hire more workers, households can make, you know, maybe nominally go out and buy another pizza a month or the likes. So their modeling accounts for these extra dollars that are getting introduced into the economy because the members of the CCE aren't paying as much for their power. The second piece is the direct piece, which is due to jobs and economic activity that is directly created by CCE activities. So that would include the individuals that would be implementing any energy efficiency programs. They would be people who would be installing the solar panels. They would be the construction workers that are building the larger solar plants that the CCE is causing to occur. And you can tell that, particularly on the first two scenarios, that first case where the general economic stimulus has a greater impact than the direct. We were asked particularly to look at construction jobs as well as what they would say union jobs or CBA, which is collective bargaining agreements. And as you go further out, there are indeed construction jobs being created directly as well as indirectly, and some fraction of those are indeed union. We were asked to also look at a more aggressive case that's in process right now, where we would assume a much greater fraction of the new renewable construction is occurring in county rather than out of county, to see if what those would do for these numbers, to see if that would be a large boost, and what that would do. That would help advise the JPA as they move forward to try to balance the potentially greater costs of having more local renewables versus the positive direct job impacts that would arise from having those additional jobs and activities in the county. Our overall conclusions. Number one, the CCE can offer competitive rates, depending on how the JPA chooses to set the rates and how they want, how much renewables they want in and the likes. There's clearly, to me, an opportunity to offer rates that are at best competitive to PG&E. Having more renewables beyond the minimum amount required by the state is economically feasible, and the CCE can do that cost effectively without driving the rates up excessively. Three, carbon reductions can occur, but require good planning by the JPA to make sure that they aren't, that when they go look beyond the simple qualifying renewables, they're getting carbon-free power. And then last, CCE can have positive economic development impacts within the county and generate jobs. So that is my summary. I am happy to answer more questions.
So you just dealt with the technical study aspects. I'm really pleased to see this. I was involved in our utilities committee in around 2008 that looked at community choice aggregation at that
yes.
time.
Mm-hmm.
And it the staff of the cities that were investigating this at that time felt it was too risky. So I'm glad that going under the county, it's a large enough potential pool to make it look like it's worthwhile doing. We are a small city, and anytime we start talking about JPAs, we've historically kind of gotten the short end of the stick around the governance issues. And you didn't go into the governance, although it was in the staff report. And mm-hmm. it seems as though the approach to do it kind of weighted votes by our usage seems to make more sense. I'm glad to see we're not the lowest energy user, but that we're the third lowest. So, and that a couple other cities use less electricity than we do. So, I'm glad to see that those aspects were thought through too.
Well, I can't take credit for that. That's part of what Michael and his group is doing on uh-huh. the JPA formation and how to try to get a fair governance that's mercifully
beyond
mine.
We've sometimes been allergic to JPAs because we get shorted on and kind of get trampled by the big guys. So
I can imagine that. I really can.
Yes, Nora.
What's the relationship of the PUC with the JPA? How does that interaction work?
The Public Utilities Commission has certain abilities to regulate the CCAs. One thing that they don't have the right to regulate is the way the CCE would do their pricing. But there are various state regulations.
Say that again.
That the PUC does not regulate the pricing for the CCA. So.
Which is different from their relationship with PG&E.
Yeah, PG&E, anytime they enter into a contract, they have to get the PUC approval. And here with the CCE, they have the ability to bypass that approval process with the understanding that because they're being governed by a local board, they would be looking after the ratepayer interests rather than the relying on PG&E to do that, which is why the PUC is there in the first place.
I'd just like to second what Ruth says about our involvement in JPAs. You know, there's usually a lot of elephants in the room, and then there's tiny little Emeryville and Albany and Piedmont. And we have come out badly from time to time in this situation. So I'm relying on Michael to make sure as you move forward with this JPA, to make sure that we have at least a fair chance to get what's right for the city.
Sure, and Mark's presentation is sort of part one of the presentation, which was the technical study, and if you're ready, I could get into the actual nuts and bolts of the JPA formation and what that would look like for Emeryville.
Yes, are there any more questions for Mark, for Mr. Fulmer?
Thank you. That was a very clear presentation of a very murky subject.
Well, thank you very much.
Okay. I noted when I looked at some of the charts that in the beginning, I guess on scenario one, PG&E actually, given normal hydro year might actually produce less greenhouse gas per unit of electricity, and that the savings in greenhouse gases would come in later years.
For the first scenario, that is true. And again, that's you highlighted the critical issue, which is normal hydro years, which strangely we have not seen a normal hydro year in quite a while. So if you look at what the actual hydro generation is, even before the drought really hit, there was still some opportunity for, well, on the base case, you would still need some hydro to break even with PG&E, but that hydro is the big swing between what the CCE can offer and what PG&E can offer. In essence, that's what that hydro dictates PG&E's total greenhouse gas emissions to a large extent.
So my question has to do with a little bit of the risk. Say the majority of cities in the county, I would probably think our city would too, choose a more aggressive greenhouse gas reduction goal. That might require some capital investment. And then unforeseeable things happen, and the scenario where we get to bail and go back to PG&E, but I assume we wouldn't be able to bail on the capital cost investments. Is that, that's the risk, in essence, of this whole thing?
That's also somewhat of a JPA issue, because in principle, the JPA shields the individual cities for the financial liability in the event that whatever investments are made, if somehow the JPA fails, that those financial obligations don't fall back on the cities. And I'm gonna punt to Michael on that, on the details.
So let's move on to the legal part of the conversation.
Thank you, Mayor, and members of the council. I'm Michael Gina, the city attorney. So the pursuit of CCE or CCA has been sort of on a two-track process. So there's been the technical side, which Mark and Nancy just briefed you on, and then there's been the formation of the actual JPA itself. And the idea behind this is that the participating cities in Alameda County plus the county would form a joint powers authority that would be governed by a joint powers agreement that would run the CCA program. And so my piece of this is to walk you through the two issues regarding JPA formation, governance, and contingencies such as withdrawal. I'll have a list of questions for you at the end of it all. It was at the end of your at the end of the study session staff report as well. I've been meeting with the representatives from the county council's office as well as the city attorneys from the various other cities to work on a draft JPA agreement. And so the purpose of this point of the presentation is to update you on where we are on JPA deal terms to get a sense from the council as to whether or not you wish to continue on the negotiation path towards a JPA with the other agencies, and to get feedback from you on the various terms regarding formation and governance. So with that, the one thing that I really want to stress about the formation of the JPA is that the point of the body is that the JPA would be a separate legal entity from any of the member entities. And that's important because the liabilities and assets of the JPA would be separate from the liabilities and assets of the city of Emeryville. The point of that is that we are trying to shield the city's general fund from the responsibilities of the JPA. And that's why it's a separate legal authority. The JPA would derive its authority from the JPA agreement, which you would approve. Assuming that you decided to join the JPA, you would then be part of a member organization that is governed by a board of directors. The board of directors would be comprised of the members of the participating entities, and each board of director would be a principal representative and an alternate. The principal representative would be a member of the legislative body of the participating agency. So for Emeryville, the Emeryville principal representative would be a member of the city council. The alternate could be either another council member or it could be a member of staff. The director would serve, the director of the participating city would serve at the pleasure of the participating city's board of directors, or of the city council in this case. Voting. So the staff report went into the voting structure of the JPA, and it's basically a two-tier type of voting structure. The first tier would be what's called a percentage vote, and that's essentially one agency, one vote. So Emeryville's vote would count and have the same weight as Oakland's, Berkeley's, or any of the other participating agency, regardless of how much power you've been pulling. The second tier is what's called a voting shares vote, and this is where it's basically a weighted vote, and the weight is dependent on the amount of power that your agency has pulled. So this is where the technical study is important, because it informs you of what Emeryville's relative share would be in relation to the other agencies. Now, the two-tier voting system, the way that works is that the percentage vote, the one agency, one vote, would be the normal way that the board would act. However, the JPA agreement provides that after that percentage vote has been taken, if two or more agencies wish to have the voting shares vote, the weighted vote, they could ask for that, and then the votes would be, then the vote on the same issue would take place based on the weighted shares. This two-tier type of voting system is typical of the other JPAs that have formed for CCA programs throughout the state, and we've been informed that of those other JPAs that are in existence that have this two-tier voting system, they've never had to invoke the weighted vote, that they've been able to conduct their business on the one agency, one vote profile. It is, however, there as an acknowledgement that certain agencies will draw more power and therefore may want to exercise that weighted vote. The other issue is the advisory committee to the board. So the JPA agreement currently calls for the establishment of a community advisory committee that would be made up of 7 to 9 members, and those members would be selected by the board of directors. The advisory committee would be selected from a range of constituents across the community that is benefited by the CCA program, and would be providing recommendations to the board. They would be serving for staggered 4-year terms. One issue that I raised in your staff report is an alternative to a community advisor committee, and that is the issue of having ex officio non-voting members on the actual board itself. That would be a yet-to-be-determined number. I think 4 is sort of the number that was talked about at the last meeting, certainly less than community advisory committee. And those ex officio members would be board of director members, but they would not have a vote. Their purpose would be to inform advise the board of directors directly in that capacity. Staff is, The staff at the city attorney's levels are pretty much not recommending the ex officio model. The community advisory committee model is a model that we are recommending. This is very typical of how the city of Emeryville operates with its advisory committees, where you have advisory bodies that make recommendations to the members, to the city council members, and it's the board of directors, or the council here is comprised entirely of voting members. But I would welcome your feedback on that issue. Funding. So currently, the county is funding all of the initial costs of the startup of the CCA program. The board of directors will be empowered to prepare and vote in a budget. And again, the idea is that the funds and the funding of the CCA would be separate from the general fund of each of the constituent cities. The board of directors would also have the authority to hire a CEO who would be responsible for the day-to-day operations of the program. That would include everything from the internal operations of hiring staff to negotiating power purchase agreements for the operation of the CCA. The board would be empowered to adopt rules and procedures that would allow for the CEO to exercise certain powers of the board as provided in those rules of procedure. And the idea is that, my understanding is that in the world of power purchase agreements, things happen very quickly. There's a very short lifespan as to how long a particular bid is good for. And so the board would have an interest in giving its CEO the ability to purchase power given the very short lifespan of how good that bid might be for. But again, the board of directors would appoint and hire that CEO. They would also hire a general counsel to provide legal support to the board and to the CEO. One other issue before we get to the timeline is the right to withdrawal. So one of the issues I brought up in your staff report is the right to withdrawal of each agency prior to the program launch. So the JPA agreement currently calls for the board of directors to be provided with a technical report after receiving bids prior to the launch of the program, and that technical report would provide information on the establishment of rates, the establishment of GHG rates, and the establishment of renewable energy versus PG&E rates. Each of the constituent members would have a window of opportunity after receiving that report to immediately withdraw from the CCA if that report found that the JPA would be unable to provide electrical rates equal to or lower than PG&E, or if the authority was unable to provide electricity in a manner that provided for a lower GHG emission rate than PG&E, or if the authority was using less renewable energy than PG&E. So this is an escape clause for the city before it committed to actually entering into the CCA program based on the information right at the time of formation. So those are the general outlines of the CCA governance and formation. So this next slide talks about the next steps, where we are and where we're going to be. Right now we're in the middle of phase one going into phase two. The check marks here are milestones that have been met, and the bullets are ones that are still outstanding. So from here, what will be happening is, and let me go to the next slide to give you a calendar. So from here, what will happen is that the various cities are going to their boards and getting feedback on the JPA agreement. July 19th, the Alameda County Board of Supervisors is expected to consider and approve the JPA agreement. Following that, in fall of this year, The participant cities would decide whether or not they would join the JPA and appoint members to the board of directors. In early 2017, the JPA, the newly formed JPA would meet, and then in it's anticipated in the summer of next year, around this time, CCA operations would be launched. So that's the conclusion of my report. I would welcome the council's feedback on your thoughts regarding the JPA agreement, if there are particular issues that you agree with, disagree with. In particular, I'd like your feedback regarding whether or not you feel like a community advisory committee is preferable than having ex officio non-voting members on the board, and if there are any other comments that you'd like me to take back to the county.
All right. Are there any clarifying questions for our city attorney? And I'd like to hear from the public
I do have a question for you, Michael. Given our really bad experience with the ACAP JPA, we took it in the chops there as far as a substantial amount of money. What specifically in this JPA is telling this city that we are not going to get involved in something like that again?
Well, first of all, we are not putting any money up front into this. So as I said in the earlier slide, the city of Emeryville is not contributing any money to the JPA, to the formation of the JPA, which is different from ACAP. All the upfront costs have been funded by the county, and the idea is that once the JPA program is underway is formed, that the JPA would then adopt a budget, and there would be a reimbursement plan back to the county for their out-of-pocket expenses. But the city is, in forming the JPA, the city of Emeryville is not putting in any money in order to participate in it.
I'm looking more to when the JPA is operating, and if certain things should happen, like happened at ACAP, what is our liability or responsibility there?
Sure. And again, the way that the JPA document is formed is the idea is that the liabilities of the JPA are separate from the liabilities of the city.
So who pays the liabilities of the JPA?
The JPA does.
And if they don't have the capacity, then what?
Then it's not coming out of the city's general fund.
Yeah, Ruth, I had a couple more questions.
Sorry.
To speak to that, what can you clarify what are going to be the assets of the JPA?
So
no, they're going out to bond. So what are their assets?
Sure. So the JPA will have the ability to go out for bonds. And that's how
to do that, they have to have something that they can get a rating on.
Sure. I mean, they would have to go out and they would have to bond. They would eventually, after they've been formed for a while, they would presumably have the ability to then, purchase their own facilities as well.
But what are their assets? What are they basing this on?
Ratepayers? I'm sorry?
They're basing their assets on the ratepayers.
Well, they are basing their assets, I think if I'm understanding your question correctly, where are they getting their initial assets? Or
not only the initial assets, but continuing on. Mm-hmm. What do they identify as their assets?
Well, I mean, they would be receiving their income through the power. I mean, they would be purchasing power, and they would be selling that power back to the various ratepayers.
So the basis of the asset is the ratepayers, essentially.
Their operating funds come out of
ratepayers.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. And then I just have one other thing. This waiting vote, you have the regular members board, and then you have the weighted vote. Does that trump the regular board?
No, it does not. So in order to have an action that was taken in that two-tier voting, you'd essentially have to have the resolution. If there's a particular resolution on the table, the board of directors would have to vote on that resolution twice. Once with the one vote, one
right,
agency.
Right, I understand that.
And then if a weighted vote was called for, you would then have to vote on that same resolution using the weighted vote system, and you'd have to get a majority passage on the weighted vote system as well.
But the weighted vote is where we lose out because we're just a sliver and the big elephants are in the room. So we've got to think about that.
Well, we get a little more weight than like Albany and Piedmont.
Yes, we do.
Sure.
Well, we're the biggest of the little cities.
Yes, sure. That's all
and,
I have.
And just in terms of context, again, you know, I can only share with you the history that I've been provided, which is that weighted vote scenario has never had to be invoked by the other JPAs that are currently in existence.
Maybe they get along better than Alameda County.
Maybe.
All right, any more clarifying questions? So is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this item? And we're still on the special study session discussing the JPA, Joint Powers Authority, for the consideration of as the East Bay Community Energy Authority. Okay, seeing none, there were some specific questions in the staff report that we can address. Does the City Council wish the City Attorney to continue negotiating a JPA agreement with the participating agencies to form a joint powers authority?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, from me too.
Yes.
Number two, should there be a board of directors? Should it include an ex officio non-voting members, or should we...
Yes.
To the
ex
officio or community advisory committee?
Community advisory committee.
I'm with community advisory committee as well. Okay. Voting rules. Are we okay with them continuing to talk about this voting structure?
At the present time.
Yeah. And does anyone have any further notes that they'd like Mr. Gina to take along?
I guess my question about this two-tiered voting thing is why not just do weighted votes all the time and know that the city's rep, you know, has a little extra oomph? I guess it's up to the way you described it, it's up to the JPA board members to call for a weighted vote, but what difference would that really make in a contested decision?
Sure. Well, I suppose the idea is that from Emeryville's perspective, given that our weighted shares would be relatively lower than Berkeley or Oakland, we would be interested in having the one agency, one vote scenario to be the majority of ways that we vote, because our
right.
vote would be just as much, have just as much weight as Oakland's. So from that perspective, I would recommend that we certainly keep that one agency,
absolutely.
One vote scenario.
I see, okay. All right,
okay. So I think that's all of our direction on this. And so that will conclude the study session. So folks who just walked in, those of you who are following along, we are now on the yellow agenda. This is a special meeting. We've got a couple more quick ones to go before our regular meeting, if you're here for the regular meeting. Calling this meeting to order. It is 7:17 p.m. And we please note we've already done the Pledge of Allegiance. Please note we are all still here. Is there anyone who wishes to comment on this special meeting where we will be hopefully appointing members to various committees and commissions? Okay, seeing none, we're moving on to item 5.1. This is where we're going to explore the appointment or reappointment of folks to Planning Commission. So I believe I have a set of interview questions. I've got an extra set if anyone else would like to review them. And let's see.
Sure.
Can I just see who's in the room? Is Commissioner Keller in here? Hello. Is applicant Robinson here? That is a no. And Commissioner Kang is here. So both of your names start with K, but if I were to go alphabetically, Sam, you'd be up first.
Mayor Martinez?
Yes.
Would you like for me to time their responses or not?
I think that they know that we're just going to keep things rolling and be succinct.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Charlie. All right, Sam. So I believe you've been briefed on what questions I'm going to ask you. So the first one is, and I apologize if you haven't, short personal statement. Why are you interested in serving on the city's planning commission? In your response, please include a summary of your relevant education, skills, and experience, including past civic involvement.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Thank you, my fellow council members. To keep it brief, last year when I was first appointed by this body to the commission, I wanted to serve my folks more locally. I've been able to serve the public in various capacities as an organizer, as an advocate, as an attorney, but I wanted to go more local. So I bring almost 10 years of legal training experience on various public policy issues ranging from climate change to fighting economic injustice to transportation, and I bring that to the commission every time on the dais. I've also served on numerous sports commissions myself, serving the public, both at the county, at the regional, as well as at the state level. And I'd like to continue serving the public in the city of Emeryville in that fashion.
Okay. What do you see as the role of a planning commissioner?
Well, besides the more technical aspect of advising this body of issues of development that come before our commission, I really take a keen interest on the aspect of maintaining and promoting the economic, the diverse richness of our city. There have been a few applications that have really surprised me. There have been really a couple of applications that really surprised me where if I hadn't been on the dais, I think that there have been issues that might have gone by the wayside. For example, there was an application that impacted the radio transmission of an in-language radio station that might have been interfered with that served 500,000 Chinese listeners in the South Bay. There was another application where it's still ongoing. It impacts the remains of a cultural community here in the city. And yet, still, there was another application when an applicant actually had, from this very podium, spoke glowingly about how his development development said in praising it said there were things that were separate but equal. And of course, I admonished him when he said that. But each of those three instances were instances where, if I hadn't been on the dais to listen to what was going on, I'm uncertain as to whether those issues of diversity and a cultural community have been would have been raised. So. That's something I have a keen interest in terms of serving this body.
Great. Number three, describe your knowledge of the city's general plan and any other major planning documents that have been adopted by the city council in the past 2 years.
Well, to keep it consistent, I'll focus my attention on one particular statement in the general plan that really impacts me. And when it says the plan must embrace the physical, social, and economic diversity of the city. That's something that I take on very, very seriously, not in terms of just my professional values, but my personal values as well. And I think I've described why in my previous answer.
Great. Give one example of a recent economic development or housing project in Emeryville that exemplifies your point of view regarding design, community benefit, and/or community process, and explain why.
So, I describe myself often as a lawyer by training, an advocate by profession, but an organizer at heart. And the process that really exemplified, that got to my heart as an organizer sitting on that dais, was when the application involving the draft EIR for Sherwin-Williams came before us. And the reason why that particular meeting brings a smile to my face is when this room was most packed. We did not have enough seats available for everyone who wanted to participate. And that's something that really just makes me happy as a policymaker to see community involvement. So in answering that question, I think the community process that most exemplified what serving the city means to me can be exemplified what happened there because of the virtue of and just the impact the community can make when we band together to show our voice.
Okay, thank you. Are there any follow-up questions that city council members would like to ask Commissioner King? No. Do you have any closing remarks?
It's been an honor to serve the community for the last year, and it'd be an honor to serve three more years.
Okay. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you.
Now I'd like to invite Stephen Keller. Mr. Keller, you get all the same questions, starting with number one, the short personal statement. Why are you interested in serving on the city's planning commission? In your response, please include a summary of your relevant education, skills, and experience, including any past civic involvement, although we're pretty aware how involved you've been.
Thank you, Madam Mayor and council members. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having me. I am definitely interested in continuing my involvement with the city. I've been involved in the city since the early part of the turn of the century, and it's been a growing involvement, and I wish to just continue helping to make our city a great place that it is, and making sure that we keep all the aspects of urban design and those impacts on the community, as well as our global impacts, in view at all times as well.
Right. What do you see as the role of a planning commissioner?
Basically, as an advisory body to this panel, but also to ensure that proposed projects conform to the city's general plan, and that to ensure that we get quality outcomes of those projects that serve the community at large, as well as the interest of the developer and everyone that's in the community here, and beyond our community as well.
Okay. Describe your knowledge of the city's general plan and any other major planning documents that have been adopted by the city council in the past 2 years.
Well, our general plan, I was very involved in the development of our new general plan for when it was first developed, but to say anyone is fully knowledgeable of that huge document is... would have to be a very Einstein type person. But there are the 10 guiding principles of the plan that I'm very supportive of, and two of those being a walkable, fine-grained city and a diversity of transportation modes. Those are two things that I find very close to my interests and desires. Since my being on the Planning Commission, the city has adopted the family-friendly design guidelines and the new development fees, as well as we've gone through a major change in our bonus point system. So there have been a lot of iterations and changes in that, and it's very important to stay abreast of those items.
Okay. Please give one example of a recent economic development or housing project in Emeryville that exemplifies your point of view regarding design, community benefit, and or process, and explain why.
Well, there's going to be kind of two, and kind of in tandem, because they're both really good. I'm very proud of the 3900 Adeline affordable housing project. I think that's one of the most stunning affordable housing projects I've seen in the area altogether. The community benefits are obvious, to finally get some affordable housing for people that can live and stay in the community in the area in which they work. I think that's very important. And I think the marketplace, the whole FDP of the marketplace, has been really, really important. We're going to finally see our city become a more urban center. And I think the mixed use of that project and the enlargement of the park, and then how that will be a catalyst to finishing the lots on Christie Avenue and finishing that out, I think that's just going to be a very good project for us, and it's going to finally give us the fine-grained city that we're looking for.
Okay. Are there any follow-up questions from council for Commissioner Keller? Thank you.
Okay, closing statement?
Oops, closing statement, please.
No, yeah. Just that it would be an honor to continue serving the city and to shepherd through the projects. And in the first question, I didn't give you an example of the experience and et cetera. So I've been on this planning commission for 3 years, and at the same time, I was on the Economic Development Advisory Committee. I've served on the Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Committee. And outside of the city, I was also a member and the chair of the Staff Advisory Committee for the School of Public Health at UC Berkeley. And currently, I'm an asset manager for UC Berkeley, where I have 15 buildings under my responsibility. So the built environment is something that's very dear and near to my heart.
Great.
Thank you
very much, Commissioner Keller. And I will ask again, is Amina Robinson here? And she is not. So we've got three openings and two applicants.
May I make a general statement to, because there's a number of planning commissioners here. Mm-hmm. And so it's not geared towards any one particular person. But one of the most important things, I think, for the Planning Commission is to weigh in on design review. And I've been really disappointed at how the new construction looks, and would hope that you would have a better eye for approving things that look better. So, and I can talk to people offline about what that would mean, but I'm really tired of this tired industrial corrugated metal thing. There's zero lap siding coming in. I could go, everything is a flat roof. There's no gabled roof anymore. And it's like, we just do this cookie cutter kind of building that looks ugly, and it doesn't stand the test of time. And so that's just a general comment to the what the Planning Commission approves in terms of trying to improve what the buildings actually look like.
I move the resolution for Sam Kang and Stephen Keller.
So we have a motion from Davis. We have a second from Atkin. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this item? Any more discussion?
No, it was Davis.
So I just want to clarify, since we have three spots and two applicants that we're voting to approve, that will leave a gap. So we will need to post this position again, and I definitely will be out there talking to folks, and I encourage my colleagues to talk to folks who may be interested in applying for Planning Commission. Can I get an idea from staff on when applications would be due? What that process
notices
would look like?
Notices were issued this week. We usually allow 45 days.
45 days?
To receive. And
okay.
Then the following council meeting after that.
And Charlie, I know you may be hampered by having a vacancy. Do you foresee any big issues that we should be aware of?
Tie votes?
Nothing comes to mind. We have had vacancies in the past, and we have managed to survive. So it would be desirable, obviously, to have a full contingent of seven commissioners, but we will be able to get along with six until you can find a seventh to appoint for us.
Okay. Thank you. So we have a motion and a second. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
I move the resolution appointing Ali Medina to the Parks and Rec Committee.
Second.
Third.
Oh. So motion by Davis, second by Asher. I don't think Allie is here. She sent us an email that she would not be here. Does anyone else wish to speak on this? I don't think so, because there's no competing applicant. So any discussion? No. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Moving on to item 5.3 for housing.
Second.
No, go ahead.
Buzz Cardoza, Mr. Chong, Frank Jordan, and Ed Troiding to the Housing Committee.
Second.
So we have a motion by Davis, a second by Asher. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this? Seeing none, is there any discussion? Would the clerk please
Mayor,
call the roll?
I would like to confirm the appointees.
So there are four openings, and the motion was to appoint the four applicants.
Okay.
And did you get the motion and the second?
Yes. Councilmember Davis and Councilmember Asher.
Yes.
Okay. Are we ready for a vote?
You were ready for a vote.
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
And that takes us to item 5.4.
Move the resolution appointing Betsy Cooley and Bob Lee to the TMA, and requesting a change that states that this will be through April 30th, 2019.
Second.
So we have a motion by Davis, second by Asher, with some changes, term through 2019. for applicants Cooley and Lee. Got that?
Yes.
So is there anyone from the public wishing to speak on this item? Is there any further discussion? Then let us please take a vote.
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
All right. Congratulations to our applicants, and thank you for stepping forward to serve your community. This special meeting is adjourned. Okay. So now we got a quick one-minute meeting, unless someone pulls an item and we need to discuss it. But we're on the blue agenda. This is the City of Emeryville as successor agency to the Emeryville Redevelopment Agency. The time is 7:34. Calling this meeting to order. Please note we are all still here. Is there anyone who wishes to comment on items within the subject matter jurisdiction of Emeryville as the successor agency to the Emeryville Redevelopment Agency? Okay, seeing none.
Consent calendar.
Second.
We have a motion on the consent calendar.
I'd like to discuss it. Is there anybody from Operation Dignity here tonight?
Oh, yes.
Okay, great.
Good.
Well, I think I just want to make a few comments before the vote, which is that I'm glad to see you here, and I love the work of your organization. I was involved with homeless veterans in the 90s, so I'm familiar with the organization and just think it's terrific and glad you'll be coming to town.
Would you like to speak?
So thank you, Mayor and City Council members. My name is Judy Huey Pasquini, and I am the interim executive director at Operation Dignity. We serve homeless veterans, that's our primary goal, and we operate emergency transitional and permanent housing sites throughout Alameda County. So, and on any given night, we serve about 130 veterans between our sites. And so thank you for this opportunity to move into Emeryville. We lost our lease in Oakland. We've been in Jacqueline and Square, and you know, it's quite the tech boom down there right now. And so, you know, we are working with Ebalsi to find a suitable space for us for our administrative offices, where we will have our executive offices and our finance and drop in for veterans to come in and apply for housing, pay their rent, and that sort of thing. Are there any questions from the?
You got a wonderful location for public transportation.
Yeah.
And
a real hub.
Yes, and that's, you know, we were searching quite a bit. And so, you know, we had found a space in Alameda, but it was behind the tube. And so, you know, for our low-income veterans, there's
too hard to get to.
Exactly. And so here on San Pablo, we'll be close to the VA, where we get the majority of our referrals. And, you know, we'll, and of course, access to public transportation. So that's great.
Welcome to our city.
Is Bob Kennedy still involved?
I'm sorry?
Is Bob Kennedy still involved?
No. Well, I've been there since January, so okay. I'm not familiar with the name.
Okay. But Alex?
Alex retired in December.
Okay.
But he's still part of our board.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you so much, and welcome to Emeryville. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on this item? All right, so we have a motion by Davis, second by Asher. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Yes, yes, yes.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
All right, with that, this meeting is adjourned. Now we are finally on to the green agenda. This is the regular city council meeting, and it is 7:37 p.m. Please note we already did the Pledge of Allegiance at an earlier meeting. We are all still here. Is there anyone at this time who wishes to make public comment? I do have one speaker card from a Mr. Bill Pinkham. So Bill, stand by while I just complete my announcement. These public comments are for anything in the subject matter jurisdiction of City Council, but not on this agenda or things that are within the consent items, so items that start with a 5. And I know, Mr. Pinkham, you're here for item 5.6. So, yes, so please come forward. So this is item 5.6 is the resolution in support of Bay Area Air Quality Management District consideration of Rule 1216.
Good evening, council members. I'm very happy to see that you're considering adopting, becoming part of the CCA. We are in Richmond. We have been part of Marine Clean Energy for a couple of years now, and I'm real happy that when I pay my electrical bill, it goes to renewable energy. In Richmond, we're no strangers to the effects of emissions from refineries. I won't talk about the disaster that happened in 2012, but I would rather at this point talk a little bit about the need to cap greenhouse gas emissions from those refineries and other places. Now, I could talk about the facts that many of you know about the very fast, very quick progress of the side effects of global warming, you know, like the destruction of the coral reefs, blanching, and the recession of major glaciers, and that sort of thing. I'd rather talk about, very quickly, about the most serious aspect of global warming, and that's what kind of planet are we going to leave our descendants. So I would ask you to just consider three important points. One, consider the children. Two, consider the children. And three, consider the children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pinkham. Is there anyone else who wishes to make public comment at this point? Come forward, Mr. Carpio.
Miss Archer, this is one of the book on the chemistry that was flooded as a reason for you to come and dismantle the scaffolding of my stainless steel roof. You know, so my whole life, all scientific life is ruined. So what are you going to do about it? I know you're not responsible, you were the mayor, but still.
You
know.
I can't
hear you, Mr. Carpio. So, my name is André Carpio. I'm a whole resident of Emeryville. I first came to Emeryville in 1962. Then I bought a house in Emeryville. And I still think everything is okay. It's just that there is a lot of misconception. And this, especially about the climate warming, you know. Anyone who has had an education in scientific education that does not overlap the basic principle of chemistry, know that the climate warming, I don't want to say it's a joke, but the scientific community calls it a fraud, and I agree with that, because of the state of the water, which freezes and boils and vaporizes and all that. So it makes the climate automatic. And when we blame everybody else, the motor, the train, la 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 la, we forgot to blame all the volcano that pops every once in a while, about every week. And I remember the one in Mont Saint Helena. There, you know, I was at proximity, and I look at it and I say, well, that was at least a million car pollution in a million years. The whole stratosphere was just plugged with pollution. So the only thing that I know is that we are blaming basically the people who work in a fossil fuel industry, and we want to shut down the coal and all that. And when you shut down the coal, you have to realize that we replace the fuel, and few people are interested in flying. I just tell you right now, the coal will not make airplane fly, but will be a substitute for energy for the fossil fuel to be transformed for the plane could travel. And having you on board and whatnot. And I'm telling you, along the railroad track here, each black tank that you see there is the fuel necessary for one round trip from here to the East Coast. So if you complain about this tank there, just cancel your trip. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes? Please just come forward. You have 3 minutes.
My name is Nan Parks McCarthy, and I'm a resident of Watergate here in Emeryville. And I really want to express my appreciation for you, the mayor, and everyone on the council for putting this on your agenda. I come here as a mother and a grandmother, concerned about our children living here in the Bay Area. Every day, the 5 refineries spew out noxious gas and black carbon particulate matter, which lodge into the lungs of vulnerable children and adults, causing serious lung disease. I know that you probably read that the American Lung Association gave the Bay Area a D in air quality. I also have an article from the New York Times, March 15th, 2016. Stating that 25% of all the deaths in the world are caused by impure air and polluted water. I also have an article from The Guardian, June 9th of this year, stating that air pollution has become a major contributor to stroke for the first time, with unclean air now blamed for nearly one-third of the years of healthy life lost to the condition worldwide. So please support this resolution. Please vote yes. And with your influence, could you please contact the Bay Area Air Quality Management District and let them know that the people of Emeryville and East Bay are concerned about all the people living and breathing here in the Bay Area. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mayor Martinez, honorable members of the council, ladies and gentlemen of Emeryville, good evening. My name is Roland Esquivias. I'm from the California Public Utilities Commission, and I'm here to offer my services as your liaison to my agency. And I would also like to invite you personally to our rate design forum, which will be next Tuesday, June 28th in Oakland, 1 Frank H. Ogawa Building, their council chamber. And in the forum, one would learn why we decided this new rate structures, which began June 1st, and then how it will be lowered to 2 tiers next year, and how we are going to implement the time of use rates on January 1st, 2019. Also, one can learn the steps on how to manage energy consumption and energy bills, and how utilities and communities work together to ensure consumers to be ready for these changes. And I was here for like half an hour, and I heard the pitch of JPA, and I think probably you guys are on your way to be a CCA or a CCE. This forum will also serve as a good platform for you to voice out your concerns and issues. I am looking forward to seeing you there. Thank you so much and have a great evening.
Thank you. You can share any of that information with our city clerk if you'd like her to pass it along to us. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak? Come, please come forward.
Good evening. Mayor Martinez and members of the council, thank you very much for the opportunity of speaking tonight. I'm Janet Johnson. I've come here from Richmond, where I live downwind from the Chevron refinery for 35 years. And I represent the Richmond Progressive Alliance and Sunflower Alliance. And I want to comment on item 5.6 on your consent calendar, a resolution calling on the Bay Area Air Quality Management District to impose a quantitative limit or cap on refinery emissions. If enacted, this measure would make Bakmud the nation's first regional air district to go beyond state and federal mandates in regulating refinery greenhouse gases, or GHG emissions, the pollutants that fuel global climate change. In fact, the cap offers local elected officials a rare opportunity to make a significant contribution to heading off the catastrophic effects of global warming. The Bay Area Refinery Corridor in Contra Costa and Solano counties constitutes the country's second largest oil production center west of Houston and is the largest industrial source of GHGs and particulate matter. The pollutant that we have already heard is causing an estimated 2,000 to 3,000 deaths per year in the Bay Area, and is the refineries are responsible for roughly 15% of the Bay Area GHGs. In recent years, oil corporations have intensified their push to make the Bay Area into an international hub for refining and shipping one of the world's most carbon-intensive and polluting fuel sources, Canadian tar sands. Increased tar sand refining poses an increased threat to public health. The same combustion processes that release climate pollution also emit toxic effluents that cause cancer, neurological damage, stroke, heart disease, as well as particulate matter that penetrates lungs and clogs arteries. The oil sands, tar sands production causes about three times the carbon pollution of conventional crude, and 800,000 barrels per day, the amount the oil industry wants to bring to California in the next decade, equals the annual emissions of 33.7 million vehicles. I could go on, but you get the drift. This is a pretty serious situation. We have the Sunflower Alliance and 350 Bay Area has a lot of information on this. If you want to get in touch with either organization, you can just Google them. And thank you so much for your time. We urge you not only to pass this consent calendar item, but to, as Nan said, please contact people on Bakmud and tell them that this is not just a local, but a global problem, and that they need to step up. Thank you.
Okay, is there anyone else who wishes to speak? All right, we will move on. Is there a city manager's report?
No report this evening, Madam Mayor.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to move the consent calendar, but I'd like to pull 5.3 just to make a comment.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second on everything but 5.3.
Well, actually, the motion includes 5.3.
Includes 5.3,
because
okay.
Because I want to go ahead with it this year.
Okay.
But I would urge the council to instruct the staff that next year, before this comes back, that we go out and do a request for proposals and tighten up what we're expecting from these lobby people that we pay $100,000 for. I'm particularly concerned about the flow of grants to the city on a local level. We get a lot of information from towns and on federal and state, and the information's very welcome, but I get a lot of that information from several other sources. I don't want to pay for stuff that I get free. So I'm just suggesting we go out and do a real analysis of what we want from the lobbyists and what we can get for the money. So with that, I moved approval. I got a second. Call the question.
We have approval. We have the second. I would like to give our representative from Townsend a chance to respond before we take our vote.
Absolutely, Madam Mayor and member of the City Council, Nicolo DeLuca from Townsend Public Affairs. Thank you for your time this evening. Council Member Davis, definitely understand where you're coming from. I would like to add, we are an active member of the city's grants team. So once a month, I think it's the third Thursday, we come together. I'm actively involved, whether in person or on the phone. Lately, it's been on the phone because I'm up in Sacramento, and we discuss grants. In fact, Last week, we were the lead for the city. We submitted an application to the state for active transportation funding. And then we're also working closely with the police chief to submit an application for COPS funding. So when we do our Friday updates, we primarily talk about just legislation, but we're very actively involved in the grant writing, submitting the applications, and working on funding too.
Well, I very much appreciate the work that you do and the work you have done for the city.
Certainly.
But I think it behooves the council to take a fresh look and take an analysis of what it is we really want. You have a wonderful organization, sir, and you have done a good job for us, but we always look for better.
Absolutely. I understand. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicolo. All right, we have a motion and we have a second. Any more discussion? Will the clerk please call the roll?
This Council is the entire Member Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Okay, we're moving on to the public hearing. So we're on to item 6.1. Resolution of the City Council of the City of Emeryville approving a modification to Resolution Number 16-33, granting a waiver for the noise ordinance to Emory Unified for construction work on Saturdays from April 9th to July 30th. So is there a staff presentation?
Good evening, Mayor, Council members. This will be a really short presentation. As you may recall, in April of this year, the Council approved a noise waiver to allow Turner Construction to do construction work at the ECCL on all Saturdays starting from April till the end of July. As a part of that approval, one of the conditions that was imposed was during Saturday construction that the backup beepers be disabled. Since then, it's come to our attention that there are certain difficulties in doing that. OSHA regulations require that whenever vehicles on a construction site are backing up, they do need to have backup beepers or have a person who a spotter who allows the vehicles to move backwards. Now, Turner Construction has been using trucks or equipment which do not have beepers, and in those cases they have been using spotters, but they also have other vehicles which have beepers as part of the machinery, and OSHA prohibits any dismantling or disabling of equipment that comes in within the vehicles, and that is the challenge in terms of equipment. So what the Turner Construction will be doing in terms of how many vehicles would be using the backup beepers is 7 vehicles on Saturdays, and there will be 3 which will be using spotters. So that concludes my presentation. My recommendation is that the council delete the condition that requires the applicant to disable backup beepers. John Baker is here if you have questions from him or from staff.
Okay, are there any clarifying questions? Yes.
Question. I'd like to talk to John Baker from Swinnerton. Here's what I don't understand.
Jackie, speak into your microphone, please.
I have so many screens in front of me. I'm sorry. Here's what I don't understand. In this staff report, our staff takes the blame for being unaware of the OSHA regulations. What I don't understand is, why were you not aware of the OSHA regulations? Isn't construction and the management of construction projects what you do and what you're being paid for?
Correct. What occurred is when we started doing the Saturday work, there was some equipment that when Turner went to disable the backup beepers, that equipment didn't allow that to be done. And the owners of that equipment said that there was newer equipment. Equipment manufactured in the last few years doesn't allow you to switch on and off the beepers. And so you can't, so disabling them, there's no way to do that other than actually physically changing them, which OSHA does not allow to do. At the time of the noise waiver ordinance, in our discussion with Turner, we were not aware that there was some newer equipment which no longer had the switches to disable the beepers, and that's what the issue is.
Well, I appreciate staff bringing this back to us, but this was not our staff's fault. You're being paid by the people of Emeryville in order to do this work and to do this management of this project. I would really expect better, and I think the people of Emeryville deserve better because we've outsourced this kind of work to you. You're supposed to be the expert. So I hope we don't have any more cleanup work on items like this, and that you do a better job and do the job you're supposed to do. That's it.
Are there any other questions? Okay, I'm going to open the public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this matter? All right, Mr. Carpio, please come forward.
First, when I found out about the cost, I was amazed that the main grievance of that building is that there is no parking. We had plenty of opportunity to dig under and make a large parking, not to annoy all the residents there. And those who come there, they have to leave their car far away. And I had myself, I had a spare radiator for a vehicle I was working on. And when I came back, it was gone. And that was $190. So, you know, when I raised the question of parking, I was raising the question of safety. And since we don't have any, we have all the other things but that. And so, as far as the delay, from what I could observe, there was lots of rainy days. And those rainy days, people can't work. And so, but the bill increases. So you have to pay for the bill. The worker do get paid when there is rainy day. So something you have to consider in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carpio. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on this item? All right, closing the public hearing.
Move the resolution.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. Is there any more discussion on this? I'll just note that I have been in touch with one member of the public who lives across the street from ECCL, and they were happy to see this moving forward. I explained to her that this noise waiver was for the backup beepers and was not to extend any time, and she has been a person who has organized her neighbors in the past to come speak to us about noise waivers, and they would like to see things move forward smoothly, and they're looking forward to the completion of this project. So I just want to make that note before we take our vote. So we have a motion and a second. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Okay, I am calling item 6.2. This is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Emeryville establishing updated development impact fees for fiscal year 2016-2017. Do we have a report?
A brief one. Mayor Martinez and members of the City Council, you have before you a resolution to increase the development impact fees. These include the housing impact fee, the affordable housing impact fee, the transportation facilities impact fee, and the parks and recreation facilities impact fee. When the Council adopted these fees in 2014, the resolutions adopting them indicated that the fees would be increased every year by the increase in the percentage increase in the Engineering News Record Construction Cost Index for San Francisco, unless the fee had already been increased during the year by the City Council. The increase in the construction cost index for the past year was 3.55%. As you may recall, last December, the council, or it was previous to December, it took effect in December, the council approved an increase in the affordable housing impact fee from $20,000 per unit to $28,000 per unit. That was for residential projects. So that fee is not proposed to be increased at this time because you already just recently increased it. Everything else, including the affordable housing impact fee for non-residential projects, would be increased by 3.55%. Prior to the adoption of updated fees, the council must hold at least one public hearing and receive written and oral testimony. This is that public hearing. Notice of this meeting and the data relating to the proposed amendments have been published and made available to the public and interested persons in accordance with the requirements of the government code. So that concludes my report. I'd be happy to respond to any questions.
Are there any clarifying questions before I open the public hearing? All right. I'm opening the public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to speak on this item? Seeing none, I'm closing the public hearing.
Move the resolution.
Second.
There's a motion by Davis, second by Asher. Any more discussion? Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Okay, we're moving on to item 6.3. This is the adoption of the budget for the City of Emeryville for the 2016 to 2017 and 2018 fiscal years. Appropriation of funds from the fiscal year 2015-16 general fund, a non-general fund, unassigned fund balances, and the adoption of the appropriations limit for the 2016-2017 fiscal year. And I see a PowerPoint presentation. And Susan, thank you.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Tonight, we will ask you to adopt the operating budget for fiscal years 2017 and 2018. We presented the proposed budget to the City Council on May 24th. The CIP budget is part of the operating budget. We presented the CIP to the City Council on May 17th and to the Parks and Recreation Committee on May 18th. The CIP was presented to other committees during the months of March and April. We updated the CIP budget based on committee recommendations and the latest financial information. These changes are included in tonight's budget. A loan repayment of $8.4 million from the successor agency to the Housing Access Fund has been confirmed for 2017. The Housing Access Fund will use the loan proceeds to pay the general fund $6.9 million for the Christie Avenue housing loan. These repayments will reduce the receivables for both funds. For budget purpose, these transactions are reflected as revenue and expenditure in the Housing Access Fund. There were no changes to general fund revenues and expenditures. We presented new proposed positions, equipment, and program expenses to the City Council at the May meeting. The objectives are to expand programs to provide high quality of services to residents, increase service levels, and achieve a greater operational efficiency. Department heads submitted budget proposals to finance. Budget proposals were reviewed by the city manager and finance. We met with the department heads to discuss program needs and financial impacts. Proposals that were considered necessary and sustainable were approved by the city manager. Proposals that were not considered sustainable were disapproved by the city manager. Revenue from the new hotel is the key funding source for the budget proposals. The hotel is expected to open in late August 2016. The projected revenue for 2017 is $580,000. For 2018, it's $1.3 million. While we use new resources to enhance services, we need to reevaluate and adjust service levels during economic downturns, implement measures to reduce costs. Tonight, we will go over the budget proposals again. We will ask the City Council to confirm the proposals or let us know the changes. There will be savings from the city manager's office due to the department reorganization. The savings will be used to offset the costs for the citywide records management project. We will spend over $600,000 on this project in 2017. The city attorney's office proposed to add an position. It's the paralegal position. Finance proposed to hire an accounting technician to process payroll. The current payroll person will stay with HR. Community development proposed to adjust staffing cost allocations between programs. The two departments also proposed some program expenses. Public Works proposed to add a maintenance worker position and adjust staffing cost allocations between programs. They also proposed to purchase a cheaper trailer and a pavement stripping machine. Community services proposed to add 5 full-time equivalent positions. The positions will be filled based on program activities. In other words, some positions may not be filled if the program activities will not increase as expected. The police department proposed to add 5 full-time equivalent positions. There are 3 police officer positions. They also proposed to purchase some new equipment and hire an emergency service contractor in 2017. This table summarizes the frozen positions, overtime reduction, and staffing allocation adjustments that you saw earlier. The total reduction is about $1.1 million for each fiscal year. This table summarizes the new proposed positions. The total addition is about $1.7 million for each fiscal year. With the reduction of $1.1 million, the net increase is about $580,000 each fiscal year. Are there any proposals that the City Council would like to discuss or remove?
Before we do that, can we open the public hearing? Is there anyone? I'm opening the public hearing. Is there anyone from the public who would like to speak on this item? Yep. Am I out of order?
No, not at all. I just wanted to clarify that this is the public hearing for the budget item 6.3.1, correct? Or are you opening the public hearing for both 6.3.1 and 6.3.2?
Well, that is, you know, let's.
Yeah, we're looking at 6.3.
I could do them both at the same time, right?
You can do them both at the same time, or you can open them up one at a time. I just wanted to make sure the record is clear.
Let's do them at the same time, because if anyone's got a problem with one, they've got a problem with the other. So this is the public hearing for 6.3.1 and 6.3.2. Is there anyone from the. I'm sorry?
Is that the CIP?
It's the accepting the budget and then the resolution of the City Council adopting the appropriations limit for the budget. So it's the accepting the budget and the appropriations
CIP limit. CIP is 6.4.
Yeah, we'll be getting to that. So seeing no public speakers, closing the public hearing. Okay, Susan, let's get back to this discussion questions.
Okay, I have a question. In community services, you say the crossing guards won't be needed. Why is that?
When ECCL opens up, it's the responsibility of the school district to provide it.
Thank you.
Will they be providing crossing guards on San Pablo?
It'll be the responsibility of the school district, so I will follow up.
It was part of their conditions of approval?
Right.
Okay. Let's remind them.
I will follow up with them.
that we will not be funding crossing guards.
That would be an appropriate item for the city school committee.
Okay.
Let's make it an agenda item.
Any other comments or questions?
I have a comment, but it's hard for me to. The slide that I really like is page 20 from our staff report. So it's a pie chart. I like pie charts. And I just want to point something out here. It's from the page 20 of the operating budget. It's the budgeted staffing versus proposed staffing for the fiscal year. And it shows for each department what percentage.
Can somebody throw this up on
there? Yeah, thank you. what percentage we're allocating. And
thank you.
This chart?
Yes, thank you. Can you
zoom in?
Zoom in a little bit. Thank you, Michael.
There we go.
So a couple of things. Looking at the ask for community services,
what we'll be doing, what's about to come online, is a facility that is brand new to us, and that I feel like will require robust programming in order to fulfill the vision that we have for the ECCL. And you'll see there that we've got 34% for 2015-2016, 34% for 2016-2017, and police grows a little bit from 32% to 35%. And when I think of budgeting, it's really important to me to think proportionally, like the way that the budget reflects our values and our policy priorities. And so this is something that I just hope that we keep an eye on. It's difficult to know with the ECCL what is going to be required in terms of staffing, but I think in order to create a truly secure community, you have to have a equal investment in community services, so health and human services, along with public safety. And we should never let one outstrip the other. And we haven't exactly done that, but we're seeing the police budget increase some. And I just want to be mindful of this going forward, because elements like the crossing guard or other investments that we could make in terms of having more dependable kind of after school staffing is something that I think we may want to consider going forward. So I just want to make this comment as a kind of note for us that we're not like other cities that actually have this proportion, maybe even much larger in terms of the investment in public safety. And I think it's good for us to keep a balance and to also know that the ECCL, now that the building is going to be finished, will require, I think, continued investment from our community to really be a secure place to live. So that's my kind of one comment. And that also, when we think about kids, we need to remember that in terms of our school, the investments that we make on the health and human services side, while I have not been supportive of the ECCL, like that principle of investing in kids through health and human services is something that's really important. So rather than thinking of police on campus, we have a school that doesn't have a college counselor. Right? So those are the things that we need to prioritize in the way that we need to invest around kids in our community. And that's my one observation and comment.
So I would just ask staff, how would we memorialize Councilmember Asha's comments and try to make that comparison the next time we're looking at a budget to see where we fall, how the ratios have changed?
We can always come back with reports that shows the comparisons that Councilmember Asha just mentioned, and we don't have to wait until we do the mid-cycle budget review. We can come back sooner and show the staffing level by program. And if there's a need to increase the staffing level for community services, we can certainly make adjustments based on the funding availability and the program needs. Does that answer your question?
It does. Thank you.
Yeah, Mayor Martinez, I agree with you, Jack, that community services are very important, but I think we tend to overlook how good our police department is and how well it is supported by the people in this city. And to suggest that we should somehow equalize community services with the police department, I think we're moving in the wrong direction. And let me tell you why I feel that. This is general fund money. And if you look at the figures in the community services department about what people are being served by community service dollars, take the senior center. Two-thirds of the membership of the senior center comes from outside of Emeryville. The child development center, again, we have maybe 40% Emeryville, and the rest is people from outside the city. I don't doubt that they're performing wonderful services, but this is general fund money produced by the taxpayers in Emeryville, and I think we should be cognizant of that. And we also should be taking a look at the numbers that are served in the after-school programs. These are not in the hundreds; they're in the tens, if that.
No, they're in the hundreds.
Well,
the after-school program, we have a large proportion of students that
well,
are now being served.
You have a large proportion of students, but we have to understand that 50% of the students in Emory Unified or more are coming from outside the city. I don't want to get involved in the details of that, but we know that the police department has a strong support from the people in this city, over 85%. And we also know that if we don't maintain a good police department, if we don't give them the resources that they need, we are very vulnerable. This is a very attractive little city. It's a rich little city for all the bad guys to come to. And we ignore giving resources to the police department at a risk to all of our citizens. So, you know, you're pushing for community services. I agree with you. They're absolutely necessary. But don't, just because the police department operates efficiently and well, don't think that it doesn't need the resources that we're seeing presented here.
Well, that's not what I said.
Well, it is what you said, because you're saying
no,
move community services. You want to see the pie chart so community services is equal to police.
I didn't say equal. I said that
well,
the balance, we want to keep track of it, because certainly there are some cities who have, you know, up to 70% going toward public safety.
Well,
and so I'm saying that we're not there, that
one would hope
that, right?
You know, we've been pretty realistic about
it. But
this.
I also think that one of the reasons that our police department is professionalized and well respected is that they have the constant backing of the council, right? It's a values-based budgeting decision that happens time and time again.
Well,
and
even more important, they have the backing of the vast majority of the people in this city. And if we tend to neglect or ignore the police department in providing resources, I think we would hear
sure,
very
and
quickly.
I'm not arguing for that. I mean, I think that the ECCL bond passed with, what, almost 90% too. So people believe in education as well and in community supports. And so for me, I just want us to make sure that as we're moving forward, that the investments that we're making are balanced. In order to have a really good community services program, we're going to need to invest in quality programs and quality staffing. The reason we have a police department that everybody admires is that we've made those investments, and then we see the kind of feedback from that. And so I think that people are supportive of community services, and that the ECCL is something that I just want to say we're at the kind of nascent stages. We have the building, and thinking through the programming and the future investments is something that still needs to, I think, really be done. This is something that's brand new that no one else around us is doing, and I'm not talking about a disinvestment from the police, but to think about how we're going to build up community services so that it can also be something that we're really proud of, right? So I'm not talking about taking anything away right now. What I'm looking at is the balance that we've held and hopefully maintaining something close like this going forward. Because I do think that I know that there are some cities that continue to make investments in the public safety side and to disinvest from the community service side. And I'm saying that we're okay, right? But we need to maintain this as a goal going forward.
Okay, and I'm sure staff is hearing that that we'll need check-ins to make sure that our philosophies are being reflected in our budget, in our hiring. But let's actually move on. You know, we're talking about philosophy. Let's actually talk about the details. So let's move on to Susan's specific questions.
Any other further comments? Really, the question is, are there any proposals that you would like to remove, or if not, we will confirm that they will be included as part of the budget?
Okay, I have a comment to make. In looking at the ask for the increase in the police department, while I agree we need to increase, the amount of increase seems greater than the amount of crime. Our police department has done very well as far as keeping violent crime, all crime other than shoplifting and smash and grab auto break-ins, all crime has stayed even though our population has gone up significantly in the last 10 years. And that's kudos to our police department for effective policing. The chief is asking for quite a few new officers and positions, and I know that right now we are short because we have injuries and we have things that were a little bit under stress. The police department is working extra time because of the number of injuries, but I think that the expansion is a little too much in the ask to have, in effect, three new sworn officers. I think if I look at the crime statistics and our area served, is too big of an increase for the actual need. And if our police department were not as effective as it is, you know, I just think that our quality has been good. We do need to expand some, just not quite as much as being asked in that one area of this budget.
Do you have a specific recommendation, Scott?
Well, I think that there should be one less sworn officer position, and to try that out moving forward and see how we do in relation to crime. I just think that, you know, just looking at our coverage, yes, we have more people come to work here, but if you say 25,000 is the average population of the city, 11,000 some at night, people go to work, but other people come in 24 hours a day. If you say we have the same area coverage per capita as Berkeley, for example, and the thing that we seem to have that, say, a community like Berkeley doesn't have is a very good police response time. So I'm concerned that we maintain our police response time.
So
I'd go backwards on that, but what I just think the ask is a little much.
Yeah, I Chief Tejada, please, I hope you'll be able to speak to Councilmember Donahue's concerns. So is it correct from the slide that Susan just had up that there are three sworn officers, the two bicycle officers, bicycle/traffic, and then one community policing officer? And I think you told us that bicycle officers, you have to have them in pairs. And the community policing officer, I think I might have been told that there were some grants involved in this person's salary. Can you confirm or elaborate on that, please?
So first, I just want to say thank you to each one of you for your support. I appreciate all your comments. I appreciate your comments about having equal attention to the community's needs and the standards of service and the expectations of that service. And I completely respect that philosophy about balancing our service and resources as the community needs. So speaking about community needs, my asks are based on, for the sworn officer positions, community's needs. And the community is asking me, why don't we have officers on bicycles? Why don't we have community programs? So while Vice Mayor Donahue, you are, I think, correct in saying that this police force works very hard to maintain this city as a safe place for everybody to enjoy, to work, and to play, and to visit, there are things that this community is asking for, and they want community programs. They want their Youth Explorer program. They want their Citizen Academy. They want officers on bikes. So I can maintain the status quo, and I can do bare minimum service, and or I can increase our service levels and create those programs that the community is asking for, put officers on bicycles, have those community outreach programs like Neighborhood Watch, the Citizen Academy, doing all of the things that brings the community into our organization, which then enhances our relationships, helps us keep the city safe, because when research shows that when the police department is part of the fabric of the community and the community feels part of that police department, crime is lowered. So you're getting a force multiplier when you do community programs with the police department. I think in this environment of the negative narrative about police today, that as your police chief, and that's putting it mildly, as your police chief, it's really important to me that we become the fabric, part of the fabric of the community through our community outreach programs, because we have good people at Emeryville Police Department. We have, I think the standard of hiring at this department is way above what you see in other departments. The caliber of our people is just so high. They're so dedicated. They're good public servants, and I want to keep it that way. And to do that, I have to have adequate resources. Like you said, our staffing is taxed right now. We are down 37% in patrol. The people you see in uniform are working, on average, 12 to 16 hour shifts with little or no time off. That in itself lends to further injury on duty because they're stressed and they're tired and they're overworked. So it's sort of a vicious cycle if you don't put adequate resources into your police department on many fronts, from social relationships and engagement to worker injury and just, you know, low morale in the police department. But you do have a great police department. I'm very proud to be the chief, and I really stress the importance of us being able to do those community outreach programs. It's really important in this time of the negative perceptions of law enforcement today. And so I just wanted to touch a little bit on the crime issue. We are doing a good job keeping a lid on crime. But if you look at the charts that I have up there, you'll see that Emeryville, compared to other cities, and there are two graphs up there. One is a comparison of cities of the similar residential population as Emeryville, the 11,000 population service population figure. And you can see Emeryville's crime rate is much higher than those cities. And then if you add the visiting population to our residential population, and people have differing opinions. Is it 45,000 that we serve when our daytime population swells, or is it 35,000? So there's 35,000 up there, and you can see again, Emeryville has a higher crime rate than those cities listed, and it is rising from 2014 to 2015. You see violent crime is up. On this one, there's the 45,000 service population. So then if we look at property crime, we're way off the charts in property crime. When we look at comparison populations with our residential population, and then there are the comparison service populations 35 and 45, and we're still rising. So, you know, you can look at statistics in many different ways. You can use different numbers. I'm just saying that whatever number we've picked, it shows that crime is rising. And it's not just property crime, it's violent crime. We're not just seeing a rise in crime, but we're also seeing a rise in being the point of contact for people who have mental health issues, drug abuse issues. And as you know, I'm not approaching our issues in a one-dimensional way with just putting bodies out on the street. I've been up in Sacramento advocating for the LEAD program. We're doing, to answer your question, Mayor Martinez, we are doing a COPS grant to see if we can get funding for our community outreach officer. So I'm approaching it from different fronts. I also was in Sacramento advocating for $20 million in the budget, which was approved. So I'm approaching this from different avenues to get us to where we need to be. I'm not just relying on general fund. I believe we run the department in a fiscally sound manner, and we'll continue to do that. So that's all I have at the moment. Thank you for your time and your support. I truly respect your opinions on this.
Okay. Thank you, Chief. So is there anything else that anyone would like to pull from the staff recommendation of what's going into the budget? Otherwise,
I have a suggestion. The police chief spoke for the three sworn positions that seem to be the most contentious here. The non-sworn positions, no other council members seem to have issue with that. I might suggest that if we keep all three positions in there, that we don't constrain the police chief in terms of what those officers would do, but that she could deploy them as she sees fit to meet the various needs of the community in the best way possible. And by designating them strictly for bicycle or traffic or community policing, then that, although it's nice to have designated people in those roles, there might be other needs internal in the department that would be, in her view, more pressing or desirable to address that might not be as visible to the public.
I would support that, Ruth. And I, again, Susan, where'd you go, Susan? I want to commend you. You stepped into a very fast-moving process here with the budget. I think it was given a lot of exposure. A lot of people had their input in this, and I think the process itself was very commendable. With that, I know there's some ouchy things here. There's some things that you can't, maybe we can't fully support, but I would suggest that I would move that we adopt 6.3 and 6.31.1. I think we have to respond to the public in this city, and it's quite clear that police departments throughout California are getting a black eye because for a number of different reasons. We're very fortunate here with the population that we have that really works with the police and appreciates what is done. We need more of that interaction. And I believe these three sworn officers will help relieve the burden on the present officers and also expand some of these programs that the chief has suggested. So I make a motion on both 6.3
and 6.3.1.
Right.
So the resolutions are 0.1 and 0.2. You're including the appropriations to pay
right.
for. Okay.
We actually have more slides.
Oh, do it.
This is not the end of the presentation, but okay. If you would like to skip the rest of the slides, that's fine.
I just want to say one thing in response to Ruth and Nora's comments. Actually, the bicycle officers are really important to me.
Right, right.
I feel like I've been saying bicycle officer for 5 years.
Accessibility.
That's really important to me. And I take it for granted that the chief has to run her department and make assignments as she will. What I do not want to see and what I think we should not be doing is having officers in the school. And that should be a decision that the school board comes to and a policy that they make. I'm not sure what a community policing officer position is. I'm taking it for granted that it would just be a third position because my experience is that if you work in Emeryville, you have to be a community policing officer. I do want to say that those bicycle positions are specific and important to me. I do also feel like it's a big ask, but I've had my say. I think everyone kind of understands what I'm saying about the balance and revisiting and thinking about community services. It's very, very important that we make investments on both fronts. So with that, the chief knows what her personnel needs are, and I hope there's some bicycle.
Susan, I know I kind of skipped ahead, so we've got a motion and a second on 6.3.1 and 6.3.2, but do you want to skim the final? You know, we've been dealing with this budget for some time, so I think there was a sense of which budget items were going to be at issue, so we just hopped on them.
Right. This is the key slide. So we can skip the rest of the slides.
Well, do you want to just flip through them in case anyone has any questions?
Okay.
Just pause on each one for a moment.
Sure. This one summarizes the proposed equipment and program expenses. Just want to see if you have any comments or would like to move any proposals, remove any proposals.
So it seems like we're keeping those electric bikes. I think we're good.
Okay. This table presents the non-general fund budget proposals. I just want to highlight the significant proposals. We propose to add three positions to support the capital improvement program.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any questions regarding those positions? The new positions will ensure a successful delivery of CIP projects.
Okay.
Just some more proposals relate to equipment and program expenses. We have the funding for all the proposals. Any questions? Okay.
What are the cameras for the police vehicles? Are those license plate readers? What are those?
They're dash cameras.
Okay. Thank you.
I want to summarize the general fund transfers to the other programs. A similar table was presented to you at the May meeting. The total transfer is about $34 million. We will transfer those funds to the other programs at the end of June 2016. We also propose to transfer surplus vehicle replacement funds back to the general fund and transfer $500,000 to the IT fund to purchase a new dispatch system for the police department. Any questions on the transfers?
Can we go back to 17? So there it is again, the $739,000 in economic development. And I just want to say again that we should consider a sales tax give back to locally owned small businesses for that fund. So I hope that we are looking at that.
It's on our to-do list.
Okay, thank you.
At the last meeting, the City Council directed us to evaluate whether there are enough reserves in the earthquake reserve fund. The answer is no. We asked our insurance broker to provide recommended insurance coverage. The amounts are $5 million, $10 million, and $15 million, and our reserve balance is only $1.3 million as of April 30, 2016. So we will consider increasing the reserve fund balance when surplus funds are available. Any questions or comments? Okay. We were also directed to review the economic uncertainty reserve policy regarding conditions warranting its use. I want to say that our policy is consistent with the GFOA recommendations. We have all the criteria that that are recommended by the GFOA. But our conditions are really flexible when it comes to defining emergency situations. So I want to ask the City Council whether you would like us to modify the policy to include more specific conditions. If not, we will keep the policy as it is.
We can move on.
This table just summarizes the unfunded positions and programs. We will add two new proposals to the list. One is related to the firefighter positions. The City Council directed us to look into future funding. It's about $1.3 million every year. We also would like to increase the earthquake reserve fund balance. We will start with $100,000 per year.
Mm-hmm.
We recommend the City Council to adopt the budget.
Okay, any? So we have a motion and we have a second. Is there any more discussion?
Who was the second?
We didn't get the second. I'm sorry.
Was there not a second? I'm sorry.
I don't think there was yet.
So we have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
We have a motion. We have a second. Any more discussion?
Yeah, well, in terms of, Susan, you had a few slides back you wanted to know about if we wanted to change our policy or discuss it. And I think for the economic uncertainty, during 2008, 2009, 2010, I saw neighboring cities blow through kind of all their reserve funds that they had. And to try to avoid layoffs and try to keep the service level the same. And when we're in kind of an economic meltdown, I think people tend to be very reactive about it. So I actually think whether it's this council or some future council, I think it would be good when cooler heads and circumstances prevail, to be able to include some examples that would be appropriate to dip into this fund, not to say that it's exhaustive or all-inclusive, but to help guide in what could be in the heat of the moment. So one of the things I'll say just generally about this budget is in the almost 17 years I've served on the council, I haven't seen this big an expansion in one budget cycle. And I've seen comparable compression. We used to have over 200 employees, and which included, of course, fire department being under our own and not just part of the county. Maybe it's just because I'm kind of physically conservative, but I'm a little nervous about how sustainable it is. And even though you indicated some proposals were nixed as being unsustainable. This is still a lot of bodies to add, and then they're expecting to have a lot of, to have job stability. And I would hate to sell people short in 2 years, 3 years, if whenever the next downturn is going to be. So I'm supportive of what's been worked out now, but with a caution that adding all these positions citywide may not be sustainable. And we have a big appetite, and I'm just concerned we're setting ourselves up for needing to tighten the belt, and especially for the department heads who've been here for a while, you've seen what it's like to lose people, and it's very difficult to go through a layoff process. So I'm just a little nervous about adding so many new positions.
We will monitor the budget closely, and also we will monitor the economic conditions. If we feel that the economy is not doing good, we will not fill some of the positions. As I mentioned earlier, some of the positions for community services, they will be filled based on program activities. If the activities increase, we will fill the positions. If not, we will not fill those positions. And also, we will not be filling all the positions at the same time, so we'll have time to monitor the economic conditions and see how well we do with the new tax revenue from the new hotel. So we'll keep you posted if there are positions that we feel like we should not fill, and we'll come back and let you know. We will continue to take the conservative approach that the city has been following, you know, over how many decades. We will continue to do that. Any other questions or comments?
Any more discussion?
With the clerk. I would hope for the three new sworn officers starts. I hate to harp on this, even though we're designating what their primary duties are, I hope that they can backfill and eliminate some of the general overtime in the department.
That's the intention. Overtime is expected to decrease with the new additions.
Good.
Okay. I'm sorry, Madam Mayor. Susan, do you recall the figure of the overtime reduction? I want to say 133. Does that sound right?
No, it's about $300,000, actually.
Okay. $300,000.
That's
okay.
Good.
Yeah.
$330,000 in okay. total. Yeah.
Okay. I think we're ready for a vote.
Okay.
Madam Mayor and Council, I will be calling for a vote on 6.3.1 first, and then I will call for a vote on 6.3.2. So the motion and the second on 6.3.1 was Councilmember Davis and Councilmember Atkin. The call for the vote is Councilmember Asher.
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin.
Aye.
Councilmember Davis.
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. 6.3.2, Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. Thank you.
That moves us to item 6.4. This is the adoption of the capital improvement program for the city of Emeryville for the 2016 to 2017 through 2020 through 21 fiscal years, and authorization of the appropriations for the 2016 to 2017 and 2017 to 2018 funding cycles of the city of Emeryville 5-year capital improvement plan. Susan, you're back.
Thank you. Next, we will ask the City Council to adopt a capital improvement program for fiscal years 2017 to 2021. The City Council adopts a 5-year CIP every other year. The most recent CIP was adopted in June 2014. The CIP identifies capital needs of the city, funding sources, and project milestones. The CIP provides a blueprint for the community to build infrastructure to support a vibrant city. The CIP was presented to the advisory bodies during the months of March, April, and May. On May 17th, we presented the CIP to the City Council. We also presented the committee recommendations. On May 18th, we presented the CIP to the Parks and Recreation Committee. They accepted the CIP with emphasis on the Helic Beach Dog Park, Point Emery shoreline protection, and funding for the Doyle Street Greenway tree replacement. Overall, the committees agreed with project priorities and project milestones. They appreciate the opportunity to weigh in on the CIP. They emphasized high priority projects. They recommend adding staff resources to implement the CIP. We update the revenue and operating expenditure projections based on the latest financial information. We add a grant table in the staff report per the City Council's direction. The table presents the grants that we expect to receive over the next 5 years. The total is about $9.3 million. We also incorporate the committee recommendations into the CIP. This table summarizes the changes recommended by the committees. We increased the appropriations for several projects, and we removed the police substation and the San Pablo eastbound right turn lane projects. The total estimated cost for the CIP is $115 million. $13 million is unfunded. There are 84 projects, 21 new projects, and 3 partially funded projects. The appropriation for 2017 is about $51.8 million. For 2018, it's $9.4 million. The CIP projects are organized into 11 categories. The large categories include community facilities, housing, and streetscape system. They comprise 74% of the CIP. The CIP reflects the City Council's goals and objectives. Create infrastructure to support a livable, vibrant city. Provide a high quality of living for our community. Direct resources to high priority projects. The CIP presents financial policies that support the City Council's objectives. The CIP proposed to contribute $1 million from the general fund to support the Art Center project, commit commercial property transfer tax for CIP projects, and redirect 25% surplus tax increment to the general fund, set up an infrastructure reserve for $5 million, set up an implementation reserve for $2.5 million. The Public Works Director and the Deputy Director will lead the implementation effort. We propose to add 3 new positions to support the implementation. I mentioned about those positions earlier. The new positions will ensure successful delivery of CIP projects. We recommend the City Council to adopt the CIP for the 2017 through 2021 fiscal years and authorize appropriations for the 2017 and 2018 funding cycles. This concludes my presentation. Any questions or comments?
Okay, any clarifying questions before I open the public hearing? All right, I am opening the public hearing for item 6.4.1 and item 6.4.2. So that's the resolution adopting the capital improvement program and the resolution for the authorizing the appropriations. Oh, hello.
I got up here too soon. John Bowders, a member of the Housing Committee, also appreciate the opportunity to provide feedback on this process. I do have to say I'm disappointed that staff did not include in this report a recommendation that we made for a change. It's not anywhere in the presentation. I found it a little disappointing. In the CIP, the Housing Committee reviewed 6 CIP items, and number 6, we recommended a change on number 6. There's $400,000 appropriated in each of the next 5 years to buyback for below market rate units that are at risk of foreclosure, which once we lose them, if the city doesn't purchase them, they're gone. We have lost units, not a lot of them, but we don't have very many of them in this city. And so we made a recommendation that there be a revolving fund established to allow for the constant reinvestment, self-financing. Once the money is put in, the buyback by the city resells it, it will finance itself. We recommended moving $400,000 from the fifth year of appropriation, dividing it into $200,000 supplements to the first 2 years so that the fund will be at a critical mass at an earlier point in the CIP timeline, simply because $400,000 in the first year and the second year isn't going to be enough to do more than support one or two units. So I would just ask you to consider that. Thank you.
Mr. Carpio?
I would like to address the new position. Is any of this position that could be contracted by independent contractor? You know, in a field of engineering, for instance, in which I did work, I contract job. I did that with De Laval Engine, Bethlehem, Kaiser, in which they don't want to hire me, but they do hire me for a proposal, for a budget that I work and want and they pay me, and they give me a premium if I finish before the time. And I think it's very economical for a company, because whoever apply for the job is specialized in that. They need to know how to go around. While here, if you are a new position, there is a lapse of time that is due to training and also training, and after that you find out it doesn't fit the job, like in the building department, so you have to let it go. In the meantime, the job is not done, you're behind schedule. And so it's something that I want to point out, that if it happened, if it exists in a industry, light or heavy industry, it should happen also in a level of city management. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carpio. Is there anyone else from the public wishing to speak on these items? All right, closing the public hearing.
And I have a question for staff.
Yes.
And the question is, how come the Housing Committee recommendation didn't make it into the final form?
I suspect it was an oversight. I think the question is whether or not, if there's $400,000 in the fifth year, if that cash is available in the fund, then we could easily slide that money over to appropriations in this current budget if you wanted to do that. The project is there. We're funding it $400,000 in each fiscal year is the way the plan was drawn up. But if you wanted to take the funds from the fifth year that were designated for the fifth year and move it forward, I believe the fund balance may be big enough to do that. So it would be up to you if you'd like to do that. We could easily add that.
Okay, so we don't have to alter the CIP.
We wouldn't have to alter the CIP, but we would have to, before, as it's adopted, if you made that motion, we could slide that money over, it would seem.
Maurice, would you like to mention where that is referenced in the CIP plan?
Sure. If you go to the project summary table on page one, so that would be in the staff report, the first attachment. Hmm. Project summary. And it's project number H06.
So there's no problem with including the recommendation of the Housing Committee in the CIP.
It seems like it could be, because I think the fund balance is there. It's just a matter of showing it in the appropriations.
What does Susan say about this? Where are you, Susan? There you are. Is there any problem with that?
I don't think so. We just need to double check the fund balance. Like Maurice said, if we have the money there, we can just move it to, move it up.
Anybody else have any problems with it?
No.
So we already had the public hearing, right?
We had the public hearing. I'll entertain a motion.
I move that we move 6.4 and 6.4.1.
Sorry, it's 6.4.1 and 6.4.2.
Oh, right.
That we'll be
right,
doing.
Sorry.
That's right.
And we include the recommendation of the Housing Committee.
Second.
I have something I'd like to add to the list. While I agree with the sentiments, and I would support that, Nora. I would like to add a project, the Pickle Works bicycle and pedestrian path, be put on the bicycle pedestrian budget, just as an item.
As an unfunded.
Unfunded item.
Unfunded item.
Yeah, we talked about that, yeah.
But I don't see it here, so.
Right.
I would accept that amendment.
Yep.
Put it on the unfunded list.
Okay.
Anybody have a problem with that?
Nope.
No.
Okay, call the question.
So we have a motion by Davis,
second.
And you're okay with the amendment, Jack?
Yes.
So second by Asher.
At 6.4.1 and 6.4.2.
Correct.
Okay.
So, Nancy, would you like to call the roll for them separately?
Yes. For 6.4.1, Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. 6.4.2. Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. Thank you.
Okay, that takes us to our action items. Item 7.1, completion of the sidewalk rehabilitation project. Is there a presentation on this?
Sure, just a quick one. So this is typically a routine acceptance of the work is complete, but we want to talk a little bit about this project given the size of the work. We budgeted about $725,000 to do sidewalks citywide. Of course, that's not enough, nearly enough to do all the sidewalk we still could do. We sized the project based on a survey of the sidewalks in the residential areas that was done by a company who did phase one of the project, which was saw cutting trip hazards. And so we packaged the project, and we came up with a bid with the lowest contractor, about $560,000, and we had a $50,000 contingency, and we tried to do as much sidewalk as we could with the contractor we had. It was a very good good unit prices that we were having. We actually exceeded the contract amount by about $40,000. We actually had one commercial property owner that wanted to do sidewalks because we in front of his business, it was their responsibility to do the sidewalk. His name is Mr. Grappolo on Vallejo Street. And he gave the city a check for $18,000 to so that we could, I believe it was $18,000 or $25,000 or so to do sidewalks in front of his property. So he added it to the scope of the contractor's work. And then we did a little extra work for removing trees and such so that we need to do a contract amendment to close out the project. The project is complete, ready for acceptance. We need to file a notice with the Alameda County Clerk and accept the project as complete. So the other item we need to do is appropriate the money we received from Mr. Grappolo to the fund so that we can use those funds to pay for the work in front of his property.
All right, any clarifying questions?
I have one comment, I want to say that I was glad that we finally did something about sidewalks, but that this project in many spots took a long time, made people's driveways and houses inaccessible, and several areas in the triangle very dangerous, and signs and tape were not routinely kind of maintained and put up. The noticing for a project like this has to be better. And I don't care if, if the contractor is going to drop the ball, then maybe that's something that we need to take better responsibility for, because it seemed like the never-ending project, and there was signage that was wrong, and folks were just not clear when it was going to end. So I think that we have to have better follow through and be very clear about what our standards are as a city in terms of making sure that our residents are well notified of what we're doing, and that they're not terribly inconvenienced, and that we don't have the kind of dangerous conditions that we saw in a couple of spots in town. So, I know we don't do sidewalks very often, but I think that's just more of kind of a general concern about large projects.
Right. I think we had a lot of lessons learned. It was the first big sidewalk project we did, and we covered too big an area at one time, and we should have written the specs in a little different way so that they complete certain areas before they go on to the next areas. Lessons learned. Our next project, and there will be more projects on sidewalks, and we will take those concerns into consideration when we set up those projects.
Thank you.
Move 7.1.1 and 7.1.2.
Second.
We have a motion from Davis, a second from Atkin. And I just want to also make the comment that because I live in the Triangle, the notifications were very poor on this project. I know, not just anecdotally, but because the sidewalk in front of my home, for the entirety of my home, was ripped out. I was noticed the day before, and I had ordered medication through FedEx that I wouldn't have done because I was going out of town, but I wouldn't have done that if I knew I was not going to have a sidewalk. Thankfully, they somehow crossed the treacherous path and made it to my front porch. But that's just, you know, I'm not saying poor me. I'm just saying I have firsthand experience that this, it was not well done, and it can and should be done better next time. I'm hoping, I don't know if there's something we can do in the RFP process to let folks know that that is something that we really care about when it's obscuring the public right of way.
Could I make one comment about the sidewalks? The sidewalks near one of our buildings at the Artist Co-op was beautifully done, retaining the vegetation. You came up with a way to raise the sidewalk and maintain that vegetation, and the aesthetics are significantly good. So there's, you know, the quality level was excellent on that project to keep that vegetation and still have the new sidewalk.
So it's good to hear. And of course, that was a much smaller project, much more contained. The other project was much more spread out, yeah. And we'll live and learn. We'll do it differently next time.
Thank you. I'll just give the public the opportunity to speak. All right. Nobody's here. So we have a motion. We have a second. Any further discussion? No. Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye. And I'm sorry, that was for
7.1.1 and 7.1.2.
Okay. Oh, for you called them for both?
For those, yes. The others were budget related.
Very good. All right, we're on to item 7.2. This is the resolution of the City Council of the City of Emeryville authorizing the city manager to enter into a professional services agreement with West Coast Code Consultants, also known as WC3, for a total amount not to exceed $3.2 million. For providing building division services for the City of Emeryville during fiscal years 2016, 2017, and 2017-2018.
Move the resolution.
I second.
Motion by Davis, second by Donahue. No one from the public is here. No. Any discussion? Would the clerk please call the roll?
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Councilmember Donahue? Excuse me, Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
All right, moving on to item 7.3. This is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Emeryville authorizing the city manager to enter into a supplement to the SunGuard Public Sector LLC Application Service Provider Agreement Schedule A order form for an amount not to exceed $103,529 to provide automated timekeeping and scheduling services through June 2019.
Move the resolution.
Second.
Motion by Davis, second by Asher. Discussion? The clerk, please call the roll.
Councilmember Asher?
Aye.
Councilmember Atkin?
Aye.
Councilmember Davis?
Aye.
Vice Mayor Donahue?
Aye.
Mayor Martinez?
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. Are there any reports from our department heads?
I did want to make a couple of announcements. One is, we're excited to say that our senior center will be opening tomorrow to the public.
Hey.
Utilized. There is a scheduled ribbon cutting for July 8th at 11 a.m. Summer swim lessons start on June 27th. So if you haven't signed up, you can still sign up here at our rec center. Movies in the Parks will be starting this June 24th at Doyle Hollis Park at 7 p.m. The movie will start at dusk.
What's the movie?
The movie is the SpongeBob movie.
Oh, yes.
The first one. We have some other ones coming up that I'll announce in future meetings. 4th of July has event has changed. We will have music and activities at Marina Park from 6 to 8 p.m. on the 4th of July. There will not be a run and fair in the morning on that day. So now it's been changed to this music and activities at Marina Park from 6 to 8 p.m. And as I mentioned, we have swim lessons going, but we also have public swim starting up. And then ECCL ribbon cutting is scheduled for September 1st at 10 a.m. And then we have a community open house scheduled for September 2nd from 4 to 6 p.m.
Great. Any reports from council members?
Mayor Martinez, I do have one announcement.
Sorry,
as well.
Go ahead.
That's all right. I don't know if the council's aware of this or if you have seen this. This landed in my inbox this afternoon, so I just thought I'd mention it to you. This is a notice from the City of Oakland concerning a special meeting that their city council is going to have next Monday, June 27th at 5 p.m., to consider an ordinance amending the Oakland Municipal Code to prohibit the storage and handling of coal and coke at bulk material facilities or terminals throughout the city of Oakland, and also adopting a resolution applying this ordinance to the proposed Oakland oversized and bulk terminal located in the West Gateway development area of the former Oakland Army base. So I just thought I'd call that to your attention.
Finally, thank you. Any other department heads? Council members? Jack.
I wanted to say that we had two folks in Emeryville that received scholarships from the Alameda Housing Authority. Jasmine Breedlove received a scholarship, and so did Renita Pitts. And Jasmine is attending Laney College, and Renita Pitts is attending Holy Names University. And as I said, I've been on this committee now for 5 years, and I'm always waiting for an Emeryville name to pop up, and this year I got two. So congratulations to those folks. We're very proud of you and wish you well.
Are they being honored at your housing meeting?
They will be invited to come. I think it's to the August meeting.
Okay, so we don't need to. They will be honored.
They will have their pictures taken. We could invite them here. I'll see if I can get their information and do something like that.
That'd be good.
I want to adjourn the meeting.
And then I had one other comment. I just wanted to note that the ECCL pool is available for rental. I myself rented the pool for an event this.
You didn't invite us.
I know. I didn't know if you wanted to come to an 8-year-old birthday party, Nora. but it was wonderful. I have to say that the reconfiguring the depth of the pool was a really, really good idea, especially for 28-year-olds. It worked out really well. Staff was wonderful, and it was just so nice to be back in that facility after four very long years. So I hope everyone, I hear we've had kind of light attendance on the weekends, but I'd like to encourage everyone to please go check out the pool. And I'm hoping that maybe at our community services meeting, we can talk about the hours of the pool and maybe think about how we might be a little more generous in the future to have some extended hours there, but it's wonderful.
Okay, I'm gonna leave it to Ruth for the last announcement, but very quickly before we adjourn the meeting, I just want to acknowledge the terrible gun violence that we experienced in the Orlando nightclub Pulse not too long ago, and I want to thank Councilmember Atkin for suggesting that we fly our flags at half mast in memory of those poor folks who lost their lives to gun violence. And I understand that you'd like to adjourn this meeting in the memory of someone.
Yes. I had a neighbor who passed on Sunday, and I'd like to adjourn this meeting in the memory of Arbella Finch.
Adjourned.
Bella, what happened?